चलिए
We start off with the last session of today's program. The topic is role of cochlear implant in deaf mutism. The speaker is Dr. K.P. Verma, and to chair the session we have Dr. P. Nayak, retired chief ENT surgeon of this very hospital, Dr. B.P. Nanda, CMS Adra, and Dr. P. Samantre, who is the ACHD secretary of this very hospital. Over to the chairpersons.
Dr. Verma is an eminent ENT specialist of Southeastern Railway Garden Reach. Since he has arrived at Garden Reach, we have seen a lot of improvement in our ENT department. Yes. And he has started the cochlear implant for the first time in the Central Hospital Garden Reach, and he has made our railway proud. The psychological and emotional burden of congenital hearing impairment is huge to the society. Cochlear implant play a greater role in alleviating the sufferings of the unfortunate children and their parents, so that they can play a greater role in the by amalgamating themselves in the mainstream of the society. So now I request Dr. Verma to start the proceedings.
Dr. K.P. Verma, he passed his MBBS from the Calicut Medical College, Kerala, and did his MSc in ENT at Banaras Hindu University. And he is a very energetic young ENT surgeon, and he probably had found a very good successor to my position, because I thought I saw he is very, very young and energetic. And what could I had not thought of doing in 10 years, he had shown it by doing it within 3 years. So I wish him success, and I wish that he should present his paper.
Respected MD sir, distinguished dignitaries on the dais, and all the respected audience. First of all, I want to thank Dr. Nayak sir. He helped me a lot to come over in the Central Hospital. Actually, I was posted initially at Chakradharpur, so I was not able to do much work. So I was frustrated. Then sir told CMD sir to bring me here, and somehow I came here. So I started doing some work. Now I am happy, very happy. And with the grace of our present CMD and ex-CMD Dr. Swai, I could start this program in this hospital. And hope this program will go on. So today I am going to present role of cochlear implant in deaf mutism. These are photographs of two children who has been implanted at our hospital. The first one is the first case, Master Ayush Kumar Chaube. He was implanted at the age of 3.5 years, 1 year back, in 24th of July 2012. And the second one is the son of one of our matron's son at Adra division, and he was implanted on 26th of July 2013. This is the third case. This is a non-railway case we have implanted in our hospital, and he was also got implant on 26th of July 2013. Till date, we have implanted 4 cases in our hospital, and 3 more cases are on pipeline. Very soon, we will implant them on our hospital. So, something regarding anatomy of ear. Ear consists of 3 parts: external ear, which consists of pinna, externality canal, and tympanic membrane. From tympanic membrane to the stapes is middle ear, and then onwards is inner ear. So this implant goes inside the inner ear, in the cochlea. So what are the prevalences of hearing impaired children born with hearing impaired? So every year about 12,000 babies are born with hearing loss, and the incidence is around 0.5 to 4 cases per 1,000 live births. And the most common causes is genetic, almost comprising of half to 2/3 cases are genetic, rest are non-genetic or environmental. The most important causes of genetic are non-syndromic, and about 30% cases are syndromic, which includes other symptoms as well, like Usher syndrome, which is having retinitis pigmentosa along with hearing loss. Then Pendred syndrome, having hypothyroidism, Jervell-Lange-Nielsen syndrome, which is having prolonged QT syndrome. And the most common cause of genetic disorder is single gene mutation. Among these, the most common is connexin 26 mutation. Then mitochondrial mutations are also involved. Among non-genetic and unknown causes, trauma before or during birth, low birth weight, bacterial and viral infection. Then research is underway to reduce the number of unknown cases, and scientists think that more than half the cases are genetic. And with time, the number of non-genetic unknown cases will reduce because the improvement of health. So the first treatment which should be given to the hearing impaired person is hearing aid. So what happens when hearing aids are of no benefit? When damage to the inner ear is substantial, even the most powerful and sophisticated hearing aid may not make sounds loud enough or clear enough to listen. Cochlear implants may be an excellent option because they bypass the damaged inner ear or hair cells and directly stimulate the outer nerves, which send signals to the brain. So this area is mild to moderately severe, up to 70 decibel of hearing loss. Or this area can be managed by hearing aids. Beyond this, that is severe to profound hearing loss, hearing aids are very not much benefit, so we have to implant these children. So what is cochlear implant? A cochlear implant is a hearing prosthesis designed to restore or provide a level of auditory sensation to adults and children who have a severe to profound bilateral sensory neural hearing loss impairment, and who get limited benefit from hearing aids. It comprises of 2 parts. One is external part and another is internal part. The internal part is implanted. The external part is just like hearing aid, which consists of main body, the processor. This processor converts sound energy into signals, which is divided into multiple channels, and through a wire, it goes to stimulator. This stimulator is having a small magnet. With the help of magnet, internal part is also having a magnet. So with the help of this magnet, this part is held there, and this stimulator gives sound signals to internal part, which converts this internal part, this sound signal into electrical stimulus. This electrical stimulus directly initiates activity in auditory nerve, that is its nerve, and child listens. So what are the consequences of unmanaged hearing loss? There will be delayed and limited language development. The child will have limited access to education. They'll have underemployment and unemployment. There is difficulty in participating in social activities, and there is negative impact on physical and mental health. What are the benefits of cochlear implants? This helps in development of useful levels of spoken language, helps in integration into the mainstream education. Scholastic achievements are better with implants, and they will have more opportunities in employment. They will lead a social independent life, and overall their quality of life will improve. So, which child are candidates? Every deaf child we cannot implant. We have to undergo through certain criteria. So these are the criteria: lack of progress in auditory skill development, no physical contraindication for the placement of the implant. After imaging studies, the cochlea should be normal. Medically declared clear to undergo surgery, and there is realistic expectations and commitment to follow up the appointments. Candidates in adults are almost same, only age is more than 18 years. Bilateral severe to profound sensorineural hearing loss. Postlingual onset of profound deafness. There are limited benefits with appropriately fit hearing aids. There is no physical contraindications for placement of implant. And he is medically clear to undergo surgery. And there is realistic expectation and commitment to follow up appointments. So, these are audiograms for candidacy. The first audiogram, the red line is the area where our audiogram will come. Lower frequency will have a better hearing results, and higher frequency will have more loss, around more than 70. And after implant, after this hearing aid trial, this hearing threshold should come up to that gray area. If it is not coming to gray area, means it is not working properly. So this children should be implanted. Then how the ear works? The sound energy travels as a wave from pinna to eardrum. It hits the eardrum. Then three ossicles vibrates and pass the vibration to the inner ear fluid, that is perilymph. Then perilymph, there are changes in the outer hair cells which creates electrical signals which passes through the auditory nerve to the brain. So why cochlear implant? Because hearing impaired children will have these problems. Their voice is monotonous, irregular, and excessive stress during phonation. Proper rhythm is not present. They speak at very slow rate. They speak with nasalized tone. It is high pitched, and there are many breaks during the phonation. They are not able to phonate some specific letters like sa, sha, sa, and these letters, and sound is distorted. And there is delay in language development. What are reasons? Hearing aid is not giving complete access to speech sounds. Flaw with the speech therapy. So we have to compare cochlear implants and hearing aids. The function of hearing aid is through it utilizes the residual hearing, requiring the functionally damaged hair cells to produce hearing sensation. That is very difficult. But the cochlear implant bypasses these damaged hair cells and directly stimulates the nerve. There is little or no gain in the high frequency region with hearing aid, but with implant we can augment up to 150 to 8000 Hz. So before starting an implant process for children, we have to get the referred patient. As soon as the child is detected of hearing impaired, he should be referred to proper center for audiological assessment. Then full medical evaluation should be done. Full audiological evaluation to assess levels and type of hearing loss should be done, including ASSR, BERA, otoacoustic emission, tympanometry, and other, depending on the age, different types of audiograms are there. Then for at least 3 to 6 months of hearing aid fitting and trial should be done, along with auditory training and speech therapy. after the 3 or 6 month period, he should be re-evaluated. If he is not getting proper improvement after this therapy, he should be considered for implant. Counseling of the parents and family members is very much required, because only implant is only surgical part. The most important part is post-implant rehabilitation. That is very much important, and the involvement of family members, parents, especially parents, is very much required. And acceptance for implant and final counseling, because this implant will go inside brain, so many parents are afraid of getting implanted their child. These are some surgical steps which are taken from our surgery done at Southeastern Railway Central Hospital. First, we have to assess the site. Generally, a flat area of the skull is taken to fit the implant properly and prevent extrusion. Then the external device fitting site is marked. Then markings are given, and these two parts should not be overlapped. The internal part and external part should not overlap. Otherwise, there will be dehiscence after some time. Flaps are elevated. The flaps should be elevated in two layers, and the skin incision and the inner flap incision should not come on same line to prevent extrusion and wound dehiscence. Then a well is drilled for the placement of the implant over the temporal bone. Then mastoidectomy is done, and through that mastoidectomy, one posterior tympanotomy is done to open the middle ear, to get the access of the middle ear. Round window is localized, and at the anteroinferior part of the round window, a cochleostomy is performed with very fine drill. After completing all the procedure, the implant is fixed on the well. Then electrode is inserted. Different companies are having different type of insertion tools, so depending on the model, we have to utilize that method. This is a diagrammatic representation after the implantation.
The external part is fitted along with the headpiece, which is fixed with a magnet to the internal part, and the electrode array goes inside the cochlea.
This is post-operative X-ray of Samuel, which was operated on 26th of July 2013. Only internal part is visible here.
We can see the electrode array well inside the cochlea.
So, something regarding bilateral hearing. Bilateral hearing, just like binocular vision, is always better than monocular vision and monocular monoaural hearing. So what are benefits? Better hearing in noisy environments can be achieved with bilateral hearing. Better localization of sound. Hear more further. With single ear, we can listen up to 10 feet. When both ears are used, we can listen up to 40 feet. Greater range of listening. Listening with only one ear is physically tiring and stressful. And eliminate the need to optimally position your good ear to capture sound. Sit wherever you like and listen. Improved sound quality is there with bilateral hearing, and uninterrupted hearing can be achieved. Now that's something to smile about. Thank you very much.
I want to add a little thing. He has told everything that 180 everyone should know, but the not the operation only, the selection of the patient is very important. Actually, it is almost 20% goes to the selection of the proper patient who can benefit from the cochlear implant. Operation is another 40%, and post-implant rehabilitation is another 40%. So all should be taken into consideration before selecting the candidate for the cochlear implant. One thing Dr. Verma has told that 18 years of the age, it is proper candidate to select for the deaf mute for the implant. But during my time, about 10 years back, what I had heard, as early as possible, it should be done so that the child is exposed to the exposed to the sound world. Otherwise, he is having a silent world. If it is done after 8 or 10 years, the benefit is less. But if it is done before 6 years, we get the highest benefit from the implant. Another thing, the adults who are postlingually deaf, they get the 100% benefit from the cochlear implant. But the deaf mutes, the earlier operation is done, the better is the benefit. What is your opinion, Dr. Barma? Because of what I had learned, it was about 10 years back. The recent things, I don't know, I have not gone through it.
Sir, actually I was expecting this question. As far as reports are coming, they have operated at as young as 7 months of the age. But depends on the normalcy of cochlea. If internal ear is normal, the cochlea is patent, then only we can do surgery. And if we are doing the surgery before 2 years, then the hearing level should be profound. After that, severe to profound ear can be implanted. And the maximum benefits if we want to get, it is below 3 years of age. After that, results are good, but not as good as before 3 years. Up to 6 years, it's okay. After 6 to 11, results may be plus minus, it's unpredictable. But still we are implanting in the hope that patient will get something. And after 11 years, patient will have hearing sensation, but they will not have any language development or any meaningful meaning of the sound.
Thank you.
The other part is, besides selection of patient, surgical procedures, the vital part is post-operative training part, post-operative rehabilitation. I think there are very few centers in Calcutta where the proper training is required for linguistic development. You know, language develops from very birth. Since you have deferred child's operation, so language development is slow, definitely. So proper post-op rehabilitation should be emphasized and explained to parents so that child pick up language better. And what are your suggestions at what frequency they should attend that post-operative rehabilitations?
Sir, post-operative rehabilitation starts with the activation of the implant. That is usually done after 2 to 4 weeks after the surgery, depending on the healing of the wound. After that, at first activation, the minimal strength of stimulus is given so that child will not feel discomfort and he will not become afraid of the sounds. Because in the first time in the life, they will start listening sound. These things are very new to them. So at first time, they will give them the minimal stimulation, that is called NRI. That is nerve response imaging. After that, at different intervals, say 3 weeks, 4 weeks, slowly the stimulus intensity will be increased, and initially they will be given the, there are 4 types of sound stimulus given. First is the sound sensation. The child will given different types of sounds like knocking the door, some bell sound, some sound at the table, and they will respond with the sound by trying to localize the sound. Then slowly, next stage, they will start giving them some just conditioned reflex to, like we are giving 2 different frequencies, one high tone, one low tone, and we'll give 2 different box, one is red, one white. Then we'll say them, when this sound is coming, you pick up the white ball, other sound, you pick up the red ball. By this way, we'll make them understand the pitch of the sound. Then some monotonous sound will start, training will start, like some sounds are A, E, U, then S, Sh, this type of sounds, starting with this sound. Once these children will get this sound, then words come. After that, means after 1 year, they should be able to say at least 4 to 10 words. After that, they will start speaking complete lines.
When to say the parents, your training part is over, you did not come further. Is there any specific time period or depending on a child's response to the...
Sir, there is no specific time period. It's a depending on the response of children and involvement of the parents. If parents are involved, some parents think that after implant everything is over, everything is fine. It's not like that. They have to get involved, they have to be part of the training. Along with the audiologist and speech therapist, they have to sit along with them. And how they are teaching, they have to teach their own house. Like some sound of auto or aeroplane or whatever, they will teach in the training. And in the practical situation, when the child is going to the road, they will pick up the auto and the mother or father will teach that this is the auto which they have taught in the, like that we have to teach them. So practical knowledge will come with the involvement of parents.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you for the wonderful presentation in time.
We would like to request Dr. P. Nag, retired Chief ENT Surgeon Gunreach, to hand over a memento to the speaker, Dr. K.P. Verma. Now we invite Dr. Subrata Lahiri, the organizing secretary of this conference, to felicitate the chairpersons. Move on with the next session and last session, and a very important topic, approach to anemia, by Dr. K. Kumar, an eminent hematologist. To chair this session, we have with us Dr.